Our scripture this morning comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. James and John, Zebedee's sons, came to Jesus and said, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. They said, "Allow one of us to sit on your right and the other on your left when you enter your glory." Jesus replied, "You don't know what you're asking. Can you drink the cup I drink or receive the baptism I receive?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said, "You will drink the cup I drink and receive the baptism I receive, but to sit at my right or left hand isn't mine to give. It belongs to those for whom it has been prepared." Now when the other 10 disciples heard about this, they became angry with James and John. Jesus called them over and said, "You know that the ones who are considered the rulers by the Gentiles show off their authority over them, and their high-ranking officials order them around. But that's not the way it will be with you. Whoever wants to be great among you will be a servant. Whoever wants to be first among you will be a slave of all. For the human one didn't come to be served, but rather to serve, and to give his life to liberate many people." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say,
thanks be to God.
Truth known to us today, for for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. From the outside, my childhood might have looked ideal. We had a house with a backyard in a small town. My parents were still together. My older brother would look after me when we played with other neighborhood kids. But what no one knew was that my dad was an alcoholic and probably bipolar. And so because of his sudden rages, he was never really able to hold a job for more than 6 months. So that left us on a shoestring budget. And we'd never have friends over, and I was stressed out all the time. But I remember when I was 3 years old, my mom took me to the closest Methodist church to have me baptized. And that's when we started attending the Plains United Methodist Church. Just about every Sunday we would go, and soon my church became my second home. I'd usually go with my mom whenever she had a meeting or during choir practice just to get out of the house. I'd sit in the little miniature chairs in the nursery and do my homework while the choir sang. I remember spending entire days there. My church was truly my sanctuary. It was my escape, my safety. And soon I knew everything about the place, where every door led, what steps creaked, how to turn on all the lights, where to find just about anything you could look for. Through the most difficult years of my life, that church was there for me. Her foundation became my foundation. But as much as I love just sitting in that building, of course, we know, right? The church is not a building. The church is the people. In the same way that the walls of that church held up the roof, the people of that church held me up. My friends and classmates, mentors, teachers, my pastor and my mom, they all rallied together in that church and made certain that every Sunday when I skipped out the door, I knew I was loved. So much more than just the safety of that building, it was the people. The people took the place of all that was lacking in my life. They loved me as their own. Grown-ups talked to me. They asked me how I was doing, how school was, or how my soccer game went. Mr. Lohman taught me my first chords on the guitar. My mom's friend Beverly would treat me like one of her own kids, especially when I was running. Miss Jane was the best Sunday school teacher. And Chris, the organist, helped me practice my saxophone whenever I played during the summer. They were always happy to see me, and they were eager to include me as I grew. They taught me to be eternally optimistic and encouraged my enthusiasm and thirst for knowledge. Now, they weren't perfect. They had their disagreements and difficulties, of course. But they loved each other. And oh, I loved them. I couldn't wait to go to church because it was there that I learned and experienced the true meaning of community. It was there I learned that what you put in comes back to you tenfold. Now, over these past 9 weeks, we've been reading the Soul Shift book together and following the disciples as they lived together in community with Jesus. And there's a pattern that we can see in all of the conversations we read about. Even after Jesus taught them that he would suffer and die for others, they were still stuck on themselves and oblivious to each other. They were living and traveling as a group, but they weren't a true community yet. They were focused on their own personal relationship with Jesus. That's where they saw this new religion heading. While Jesus was trying to do something with all of them together, they kept thinking me, when Jesus kept thinking me. So when we shift from me to we, what happens is we have to soften our borders. We have to dismantle the walls we build. Open up to people who aren't like us. Maybe people who make us a little uneasy. We have to be open to people who voted differently than us, or who think or speak differently than us. When we make this shift, we have to understand that God will open our hearts to these people that we can't with our heads possibly think there's a way we could get along. If we really are a body, the body of Christ, then truly we are each only as spiritual as the climate of our church. Each of us individually is only as close to God as we are as a church. This shift that God is calling us to make from me to we means using our gifts for the sake of the common good. It means showing up and saying, what do I have that could be useful to somebody here? And if you're thinking you don't have anything, well, I have to correct you, because everyone has a listening ear. Each of us can pray for each other. Basically, it comes down to JFK's adage, ask not what your church can do for you. Ask what you can do for your church. In our book, the authors talked about a South African concept called Ubuntu. Now, it's one of these words that's hard to translate fully. Literally, it means humanness, but it's often translated as humanity towards others. Now, Archbishop Desmond Tutu has explained it a little bit better for us. He says, it's the essence of being human. A person with Ubuntu is open and available to others, affirming of others, does not feel threatened that others are able and good. It's based from a proper self-assurance that comes from knowing that he or she belongs in a greater whole. A whole that is only diminished when others are humiliated or tortured or oppressed. Ubuntu speaks about our interconnectedness. You can't be human all by yourself, and I would say you certainly can't be a Christian in isolation. When you have this quality, you are known for your generosity. We think of ourselves far too frequently as individuals, separated from one another, whereas you are connected and what you do affects the whole world. When you do well, it spreads out. It is for the whole of humanity. This beautiful concept of Ubuntu reminded me of a story I heard recently, which is quite timely for this Sunday after Veterans Day. The story goes, towards the end of World War II, a group of American soldiers carried the body of their fallen comrade to a nearby cemetery for burial. They were greeted by a priest who informed them they could not bury their friend in the cemetery because it was a Catholic cemetery and their friend was not Catholic. So disappointed, the soldiers carried their friend's body to a place just outside the cemetery fence. And hoping to place him as close as possible to sacred ground, they dug a small grave and buried him after a humble ceremony. And the following day, when the soldiers returned to pay their final respects, they were confused when they couldn't find the grave. And after some searching, they called for the priest again and asked what had happened to their friend's grave. And the priest said, "Well, the first half of the night I spent sorry for what I told you. And the second half I spent moving the fence." Will you move the fences in your life? Will you help us move the fences of our church? When we move from me to we partner with people we have never met and include people who are not like us so that we can become what we haven't been, so that we can do what we've never done. We need new people who aren't like us to bring us into a new reality. Earlier, we prayed together as we sang, "Bind us together, Lord. Bind us with cords that cannot be broken." And I really hope we meant that. I'm reminded of the popular singer-songwriter Jack Johnson, who said, "We are always better when we're together. We will always be better together." May God help us move our fences, open ourselves to people who aren't like us, that we might be transformed into a new creation.